All right, now it's time for here is Q&A number 27. Q&A is obviously where I just answer questions from my last Q&A video. These used to be a little bit longer where I would talk about my channel and stuff before, but then I start just rambling on, so I'm just gonna get straight into the questions. First question, Hiru, do tunnel snakes rule? I don't know what a tunnel snake is. I probably could have Google searched it when I wrote down this question, but I didn't. So I don't know. Is that in relation to some kind of meme or something? These questions were asked like a month ago, so I don't know. A month ago when Legion came out, I should add to that. Next question. You should move somewhere where you both. Where you have both. Oh, I totally just missed a word. We in Germany have like 3 weeks of summer. And the rest is foggy and rainy. Germany, huh? I don't know how to speak German, though. It would be nice to live somewhere where it's cold, and you only have 3 weeks of summer. You should move somewhere where you have both. We in Germany. Looks like I wrote down the same question twice. Well, copy and paste it, obviously. I'm not gonna write this stuff down. I'm a surprisingly very slow typer. I should really learn how to touch type, considering how much I actually have to type out shit for videos and stuff. I'll learn how to touch type someday. I'm pretty fast for a hunt and pecker, but I should really learn how to touch type considering my job is on the computer and stuff. Next question. Do you have any lifelong goals, objectives, or things you want to be able to do later? Also, Hiru-san, notice me. Hiru-san, that's a new one. Usually when people use the weeaboo suffix at the end, they always go Hiru-senpai. For those of you who don't watch anime, at the end of people's names in Japan, they add extra things. The only thing we really have in English that can compare it to, it would be like calling someone Mr. or, Mrs. You know how you'd call your teacher like Mrs. Smith or Mr. Smith? They have like different suffixes. I think that's what it's called for like everything. San is what you'd call someone who's a superior to you. And then there's a bunch of other ones for like someone who's equal to you, someone you think is cute, someone who's older than you, someone who you want to show a ton of respect to, and a whole bunch of other random shit. It's not all that important. On to the actual question itself. Do I have any lifelong goals? I want to learn how to touch type. I guess that counts as a goal. If you want to be a little bit more philosophical about it, no. I'm perfectly content with just playing video games and making enough money to live off of. Back when I worked part-time at my job, which only paid minimum wage, I'd play WoW for 5 days a week, and then I'd go to work on the weekend. And I wasn't in school either, because I had taken time off. A year off of school after high school. Sorry, I just gotta reposition myself. I'm still not very good at picking a nice position to talk in with this, especially since my mic stand has to go like around my computer. It's kind of weird. Anyways, I forgot what I was talking about. Let's see, do you have any life goals? Shit, I'm just gonna rewind and see what I was talking about. Alright, so I went back and re-listened to myself. Turns out I was talking about my old job where I worked minimum wage. Funny story about that. I started working there when I was 16. And I didn't stop working there until I was 21, and that was because they fired me. If they never fired me, I probably would have still just kept working there. Or maybe, I doubt I would leave if they hadn't fired me, because I had no reason to. I was making enough money to live off, even if I wasn't making a lot. And I was content with just being able to play WoW for 5 days a week. That was a lot of fun. Oh yeah, the period of time after high school. After high school, I took a year off before I went to college, because high school was really a pain in the ass. because I had a job on the weekends and I played sports, so I had like no free time. And the 2 or 3 hours I got to play of WoW at night were like the best time of the day. So I was like, I'm just gonna do that for a year. So I just had my part-time job where I worked on the weekends and I played WoW for the rest of the day, for rest of the week, I mean. And that was probably the best year of my life. God, that was so much fun, just playing WoW all day. I also cut out contact with all of my friends from high school. Like, as soon as high school ended, I didn't talk to any of them or reply to any of their texts. Later on, I regret doing that because I lost contact with a lot of them. But I also don't regret it at the same time because I got to just sit down and play a lot of video games because I didn't talk to them, which was pretty great. So, I mean, it was both a good and bad thing. I can always just reconnect with them later on in life. I've already done that for a couple of friends from high school. Anyway. Oh yeah, I'm totally fine with just working minimum wage and being able to support my hobbies, which are pretty cheap. So, as for life goals, that's it. Just to have fun. That's basically my life goal. I just kind of let things happen, live and let live. I don't think that's the right saying for that. I just kind of do things spontaneously. I don't plan anything out. I only went to college just so I can brag about having a degree. And I still kind of want to go back so I can still brag about having a degree, even though I don't. Well, I was never really going to school for a job that would make me a lot of money anyway. I was just kind of going for the degree to brag about. Afterwards, I'd probably just keep working at the minimum wage job, but then they fired me. So I don't, and then I started YouTube because of that. And now I make way more than I did, and I have a lot more fun with this job rather than my other one. But I still like the other one, and I don't actually get to go out and mess with people anymore, which was something that was a lot of fun, but whatever. Next question. Objectives or things you want to do later? Nope. I don't like to make plans like that. I just kind of do whatever I feel like at the moment. And then I'll just go from there. I surprisingly do a plan a lot, like day to day, but I do zero planning for like the future. Because I don't really care. I don't envision myself wanting to get married and having children like the normal person would, because that's not something that I totally want to happen. But at the same time, I'm not against it happening if it just kind of happens one day. But it's not something I'm working for. If it happens, it happens. If it doesn't, that's fine too. So I can just do whatever I want because I don't care about that. And I don't think a lot of other people, actually, I know a lot of people just don't think about it. They just kind of do it because that's what's expected of them from their social circles in society and the people they interact with and their families pushing them to do it. I've never been one to listen to anything my family says unless I find merit in it personally. Merit in it personally. But then again, I've always been kind of weird. So, if it works, as long as you have fun in life, that's all that matters. Because life doesn't matter. Nothing matters. Everything is just, well, that'd be going into nihilism, and I really don't want to talk about that right now because I'm already talking too much about this one question. Come on, I was able to answer like 3 other questions in 2 minutes. I should probably skip on to the next one already. I doubt anyone wants to hear about nihilism and how the only thing in life that matters is to have fun. Everything else is secondary. You probably already know this, but with the new Iron Man rules, you choose a spec and get all abilities. Still no talents, though. So, maybe you could try it again in the future? Question mark. I heard Dispriests are really strong at Iron Man at the moment. Alright, so for the Iron Man challenge. I like doing the Iron Man challenge, like when I can stream it. because there are lots of periods of downtime where you're killing mobs and it takes forever. And that's a great time to actually interact with chat. And then there's those moments where you almost die, which chat really loves because they love to see me die in Iron Man challenges. But I have had problems where people follow me around in Iron Man challenges during streams. Like a pretty big problem to the point where I actually just stopped doing them at the end of Warlords because people wouldn't stop following me around. Why is it a big problem when people follow me around? Well, because it's really annoying. They just follow behind me and just stare at me while I do everything. And when they do that for hours on end, it's a pain in the ass. And sometimes they'll attack shit and kill it before I can tag it. Or I had this one guy who was playing an Alliance Rogue who kept smoke bombing on me so that I wouldn't be able to target outside of it. That was a pain in the ass. So yeah, I stopped doing the Iron Man because people wouldn't stop following me around. So it's not really something I can do often on stream because people will just find out what server I'm on and then just follow me everywhere. And it's a huge pain in the ass. And I could counteract that by simply just doing it randomly throughout the week and then just uploading the video. But I don't really want to do that either because I don't really want to make an Iron Man video. I already did an Iron Man series and I died at level 28. And I'm not going to do another one because I don't really want to. It's a lot of time investment. Time that could be spent working on a different video. But I did do it on my last stream. I did the Battle Mage on my... I just basically went on a mage who was already level 10 through an Iron Man, and I threw on an heirloom sword, and I went around and just hit stuff with it while my pet killed stuff. That was fun. I'll probably do that randomly on streams. But I doubt I'll do a serious Iron Man just because people won't stop following me. Yeah, and Disc Priest pretty good. I don't really see how Disc Priest could be good. Because they don't get Atonement until level 80, right? Because Atonement is their mastery, or do they get it? And their mastery simply increases the amount of the Atonement heals. You know, someone who mains a Disc Priest, I should probably know that. Anyways, next question. Warcraft Bible also made a video statement apologizing for what he did. I wonder if he deserves a second chance. Perhaps not, considering that he knew what he was doing was wrong to begin with. Just curious, though. Warcraft Bible. This kid is so stupid. I think he's 18. I'm pretty sure he's 18, and he made these top 10 videos directly ripping off Danger Dolan style of top 10s. Like, the intro is exactly the same. I think he even tried to imitate his voice. I don't know why. I always thought that was really... I was never a fan of his WoW videos. But not only did he just completely rip off Danger Dolan's style for doing it, he also just straight up plagiarized everything in his videos from articles online. And then he got called out for it, and he made an apology video, and people... didn't take well to the apology video because those rarely ever go well. There's this funny video. You should really watch this YouTuber called... Crap, what's his name? Internet Comment Etiquette with Eric. Or is it just Internet Comment Etiquette? Internet Comment... I don't know. Just type out Internet Comment Etiquette and then with type out apology videos next to it. And he makes a really funny video about apology videos. Basically, they never turn out well. And he just makes fun of them. Oh god, I love his videos so much. I've watched every single video that that guy's made like two or three times. They're just so great. So anyways, Warcraft Bible, he made an apology video for plagiarizing. Basically saying he knew he was plagiarizing, but he was getting away with it. So he wanted to see how far he could take it. Which I was like, okay, he's dumb. But the thing is, he stopped making videos after that. which is just funny, because he was on such a rise in subscribers, and I'm pretty sure most of his subscribers don't know about the drama, or totally wouldn't have known if he hadn't made an apology video. Like, literally, the best course of action he could have done, since Kakyo is a pretty small channel, would to have been just to ignore everything, and it would have just blown over eventually. And he could have just kept doing what he's doing, and he would have made a whole bunch of money. Because he was getting tons of views on his videos that he was just straight up plagiarizing. And he was able to put them out very frequently because he didn't have to do any work. His editing was super lazy as well. Dang, if I did that style, I could probably put out 5 videos a week. Oh, but then I'd run out of ideas really quickly. You can only plagiarize so much. I'd eventually have to go to making my own videos again. You know, actually researching and writing them out. Whew. Oh, yeah, so anyways, he doesn't make videos anymore. He stopped. Kakyo killed his channel. And the thing is, he's like a textbook example of how not to handle something like that. He just did everything wrong. If someone makes a video like that calling you out and they're not really that big, you should just ignore it. For anyone else who decides to plagiarize videos on YouTube for money, if someone catches you, just ignore it and you'll be fine. Unless someone really big does it. That's how you get away with it. Next question. Did you know Kakyo is from Denmark? For those of you who don't know, Kakyo is the guy who made the Warcraft Bible video. He also makes other videos sometimes. He hasn't released a video in like over a month. The thing is, his channel... Sorry, I'm not meaning to laugh like that. It's so unprofessional to laugh in these kinds of videos. Because you don't know what I'm laughing at, and that I have to tell you. Kakyo's channel has like doubled in size after he released the Warcraft Bible video, and he's only released one video since then. He really should have taken advantage of that. He still can too, but I don't think he has a video planned anytime soon. He really should. I mean, if he wants to do YouTube full time, now is his chance to really get on that, but he's not doing it. Which is so surprising. I guess school must be really hard for him. Actually, you know what? How do you start a YouTube channel? I think I have some tips written up here just for Kakyo. Don't make videos when you're inspired. Set a schedule. If I only worked when I was inspired, I'd work once a month. Because inspiration is for hippies and hipsters. Or people who... don't know anything about real work. You have to, like, sort of force yourself to work. That way you get into a habit, and that will make you want to work. Inspiration is nice to start off with, but if you rely on inspiration to do videos, even though this is a creative thing, it's actually not needed. Like, whatchamacallit, I make Yu-Gi-Oh! Videos. Every day. Well, I don't make videos every day, but I do have it set so that a video will be uploaded every day, because I set them on a schedule. Usually I make, like, 2 to 3 Yu-Gi-Oh! Videos at a time, and then I'll just set them on a schedule, because I can do them all, it's a little bit quicker if I can do them all back-to-back. That way I can just do a mass upload, because there's options in Sony Vegas to do batch rendering, where you just like set little parameters for it and it will render out videos one after another, so you don't have to go through and do it manually. But then again, those of you who don't know anything about rendering or video editing, that was probably just gibberish to you. But yeah, if I only ever made Yu-Gi-Oh! Videos when I felt like playing Yu-Gi-Oh! I'd put out one video a month because I never feel like playing Yu-Gi-Oh! I hate playing those kinds of games, but when I actually sit down and force myself to do it, I'll eventually get into it. That's how you get yourself to make videos. Set a time and do it. Force yourself to do it, and you'll eventually just get into it naturally. If it's something you enjoy doing. If not, then you just won't. Like, I used to force myself to study Japanese. I'd sit down and force myself to do it every day, and I'd schedule like 2 to 3 hours of study time throughout the day. And I'd probably spend 75% of that time just staring at the wall doing nothing, because I really didn't want to study Japanese because it was so boring. That fucking class, I hate it. That's probably the reason I don't want to go back to school, so I don't have to finish Japanese. I would much rather just go back and take Spanish instead, just so I don't have to take Japanese again, because holy fuck is that class hard. I literally studied up on how to memorize shit. I put extensive research into learning how to just memorize, how to have a good memory. I have, like, an incredible memory now. I wish I had the memory I have now, like back in high school, because I would have been able to pass every single test easily with the techniques I've learned. Because for those of you who don't know, memory, they have like memory tests or memory like competitions in Europe or something. And there are literal techniques you can use to manipulate your memory. People who create new techniques for making memorizing stuff easier are usually the ones who win the competition by a landslide, and it's really like every year someone will create a new technique to remember stuff a little bit quicker, and they'll get an edge and they'll beat everyone else, and then they'll tell everyone else, and then they'll learn it, and that will even out the playing field, and then newcomers who come in won't be able to do as well unless they learn these techniques. So like memorization isn't, I mean, unless you have some kind of literal mental illness or like a mental disorder or a mental disability, you can manipulate your memory into making it really good. And I learned a whole bunch of tricks, and now I have like an amazing memory where I can just, yeah, I just have a really good memory now. Thanks to Japanese, and I still hate that class so much. Even with the amazing memory I have, I still barely failed the class with a 60. What is it? I need a 70% to pass the class, because you just need to get a C. And I got a 68%. I was so close. Man, I was so mad about that. Ugh, but I just couldn't study. I sat down to try to study, and I just stared at the wall instead, because it was so boring. Even though I knew how to do it. I had a lot more fun learning how to study than I did actually studying for that stupid class. Anyways, yeah, if you just sit down and force yourself to make videos, you'll just get into it. That's how you do it. That's literally the secret to making videos. Of course, there's a little bit more to it. I also shame myself into making videos if I get too lazy. Like, I don't actually plan anything out. I just kind of say I'm gonna have to work on a video today, and I'll do it like in an hour after I do my world quest or something, and then I have all of my time documented on my calendar. On Google Calendar, which is always open on my second monitor in a tab. Anyways, let's see. For today, it says at 11:30 I woke up. At 12:30 I went for my run. From 1:30 to 2:30, I just sat down and did nothing while I let my body cool off from my run. And then I took a shower, and then I did chores, because that's when I do all my chores on Monday. So chores include doing laundry, going out to the store and buying food, and cleaning out my dog's little pool that they swim in that they don't really need anymore now that it's fall. It's mainly a summer thing. Your dog's dying to the heat is a surprisingly a common thing in Arizona. So we have a pool for them that I clean out every week on Monday. That way there's not mold or mosquito eggs in there. And then I took a break from 3 to 6 just on Reddit, and then I recorded a video at 6 o'clock to 7, and then I took another break for 2 hours and played WoW, and then at 9 o'clock I got back to work, and it's currently 11:30 and I'm still working, so I have that written down. So I have a total of 1, 2, 3.5 hours of work today. And the reason I put all that down, I only do it in increments of like an hour or half an hour. I don't go super into detail about what I do during the day. But just enough of it, that way I can see just how much time I'm wasting. And seeing that would be like, oh shit, I was a lazy ass piece of shit today. Even though I totally did work today, I totally could have did a lot more. And it's nice to actually see that, because at first, before you actually start logging your time, you don't actually notice how much time you're wasting. Of course, if I was in school and everything, I'd probably waste, you know, even more time. But even when I was in school, I still made videos. Yeah, even when I was studying for 3 hours a day when I just didn't do anything. I had like three other classes too while I was in Japanese. And I was still making videos. So I know you can do it. So let's see. Force yourself to make videos, you'll eventually get into it. Don't work when you're inspired. That's only something hippies do or stupid people who don't know anything about basic psychology. Set routines or some kind of schedule. For my schedule, I want at least one WoW video every Sunday, and one Yu-Gi-Oh video every day. Also, Dave and DevBot at night for 2 hours. So I work on my little Machinima series from like 11 to 12. Since I just finished up the episode that I was working on, I decided just to do my Q&A instead. So usually at this time, I'm working on Dave and DevBot, since I'm working on the second season right now. And I wanted to have all that done before I release any of the episodes. That way I can work on them and go back and... Because I have actually already decided to change completely the third episode, and I'm glad I waited. Because if I didn't, then I'd probably have just put it out with what I had written already. And I would have probably hurried it out, and I wouldn't have been happy with it. So I like that I'm just waiting until I finish all the videos before I release any of them. Now I can go back and change it, or I can take my time with a certain script if I don't like it, because I had ended up rewriting the third episode because I didn't like it. Which is something I wish I had done in the first season. But yeah, anyways, those are the three things I do. I just try to have a video done by Sunday, which I didn't do, because I spent all week just writing five different scripts instead. A Yu-Gi-Oh video every day, I got that done. Last week I wasn't able to do that though. I went like 4 days without an upload, which was ridiculous. And then I have my alternate channels where I like to actually update those videos. Ever since Legion came out though, I took a break from those channels, so. I gotta add those back to my routine eventually. No days off. Every day is a work day. That being said, take lots of breaks. The thing with habits is the reason you want to form a habit of working every day is so that when you go too long without doing it, your body will want to do it. Because your body, your brain, your psychology loves habits. Your brain just loves to do something that you do every day. That's why when I got myself to go running, because I go running every day in the morning, I used to go running every day at night. The reason I don't go running in the afternoon is because I raid sometimes on Wednesdays and Thursdays. So if I went running in the afternoon, there'd be some days where I wouldn't be able to go running because I'd have a raid. And that means I wouldn't be able to go every day at the exact same time. So if I run in the morning after I wake up, I'm able to do that consistently every day. And since I have a consistent schedule like that, I have it set as a habit. So I was actually taking, how many days did I take off? I don't know, I took like 4 or 5 days off of running a week ago, or maybe it was 2 weeks ago, because I have bad knees, so I sometimes have to just stop running so I can let them heal. Because the thing with injuries is you can't just let them heal a little bit and then keep going. You have to let them heal all the way before you can start working out again. And I have a bad knee from football that never fully healed, so I just have to take a break every couple of months because it doesn't really flare up that much. Because I have a bad left knee, when it starts hurting too much, I'll just put a brace on it, and then I'll just keep running for about a week or two. And then my right knee will start hurting because it's taking too much pressure off of my left knee since I'm not using it as much. And then my right knee will start hurting as well. And then that's when I start taking a break. So that was like 2 weeks ago or last week. So I had to take a break. And the only reason I'm saying all this is because during like those couple of days where I wasn't running, every time I woke up, I was like, I really want to go running. Like, I don't like running. Running sucks. I do it every day, though, because I want to stay in shape, and I don't want to become a 400-pound neck beard, since my job is to sit at a computer all day. But I did have to take a break, and after taking those breaks, I really wanted to go running again because my body was used to it. I don't like running, but I really wanted to go running again during those times that I'm usually go running, and that's because of the habit. habits are great to take advantage of. If you know how the mind works, you can use it to your advantage. The cool thing with psychological tricks is that they work even if you know that you're tricking yourself. Like the placebo effect, very common, very well-known psychological thing, where, like, the placebo effect, the most common way to describe it is, say someone's in pain, and you give them a sugar pill that does literally nothing, and you say, oh, hey, this will make your pain go away. Since pain is something in your brain that can be controlled to an extent, if they take the sugar pill and they believe it'll make the pain go away, there's a super high chance that it will go away. And they're like, oh, thanks, that totally helped. That's like an example of the placebo effect. For things that involve your brain that can be altered, but that you can't physically control. Like, say if you're a drug addict or something, that's all a mental problem. You're like, physically, you can just stop taking drugs whenever you want. But you're going to want to keep doing them because of the physical dependency. And if you're able to take advantage of psychological techniques, you can curb those habits. That's what the whole 10-step program, and there's a whole thing for drug addicts and everything, but it works for lesser stuff too. Like getting yourself to not be lazy and make videos or going running. And if you know those tricks, you can totally take advantage of them to make your life easier. And that's what I do. I'm a really lazy person, but I get a lot of stuff done because I know how to trick myself into working. And one of the things I do is, obviously, forming habits. Since I want to have a video done every Sunday, every week, once a week, I actually want to do 2 videos a week eventually. I just set a habit for it, and once I get to the end of the week, I'm like, oh crap, I really need to make a video, because I need to have one out on Sunday. You know, setting a deadline will make you want to do it. Even though I don't really need to, I can release a video whenever I want. But it is nice to have them out at least once a week, because of the whole YouTube stuff. And yeah, that's what I do, and that's a good way to get yourself to do stuff like that. And that's what the whole no days off thing, because usually if you take a day off, I'm going to feel like I want to work anyway. It's like, I want to just work on a video just a little bit. I've been playing all day, but I'm so used to working all the time that it's just, I can't relax. But I can relax if I take enough days off and I'll completely untrain myself. And then I'll be too lazy to start working, and then I'm going to have to retrain myself into wanting to work again. And that's what happened last time I took a break to play Diablo. I took like an entire week off to play Diablo, but I had spent the previous week working the entire time to like make backlog videos, so I could take a week off. That way I'd still have videos uploading while I was playing Diablo for a week. And during the week of Diablo, like during the first day, I was like, this is a lot of fun, but I really want to make a video. I was like, no, no, I have a bunch of videos, I'm just going to keep playing. And the next day, I was like, this is a lot of fun, but I think I'm going to go on Reddit for a little bit. And then I go on Reddit, and it's like, I really want to make a video. No, 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 I'm taking a day off. No making videos, you're not allowed to. And then after the week was over and I was going back to making videos again, I was like, I really don't want to make a video and I want to play Diablo. And I can completely change my mindset to be a lazy asshole who just plays video games all day. And it took like 2 weeks before I could train myself to get back into work mode. And after that, I made my rule of no more days off. Instead, I just take lots of breaks. instead of taking days off, I just have days where I work less. Like, I'll only work for like an hour or two. So that was my compromise, to never get out of work mode. Because I really rely on my self-training in order to get anything done, because I'm too lazy to trust myself not to. Next one. Where do ideas come from? Ideas for videos. Ideas come from everywhere. I always get ideas while I'm making or researching another video. While I was researching because right now I'm working on a video called The History of Rogue Openers, Ambush, Cheap Shot, and Garrote. And while I was making the videos, I forget what, but I was researching it and I saw this other thing And I was like, ooh, that would make a great idea for a video. So I opened up my notepad and I wrote it down. And then I started working on 5 other videos because that led me into other stuff. And that's how I always have ideas. Every time I make a video, and if I find a nice idea for another video, I'll immediately write it down. Even with my great memory, I don't trust it enough to completely remember something down the road. In fact, it's really stupid not to write down ideas. I know a bunch of other people who make YouTube videos who don't write down ideas. I don't even know how the hell they function that way. It's like, how do you start a new video? Do you literally just sit there and you're like, what am I going to make for my new video this week? Oh, I don't know. Let me just sit here and think. He's like, no, just go to your idea list. Does everyone not have an idea list? Because mine is long as shit. I even have mine organized into videos that can be made quickly and videos that would take too long to make. I actually did that recently because I have such a long ass idea list that I organize it into videos that would be made that I can make easily. Videos that would take a medium amount of time to make and videos that would take forever to make. And I've been doing the easy ones and some of the medium ones and working on the hard to make ones, which are machinimas. Machinimas take forever to make. Those are definitely the highest in difficulty of all the kinds of videos I make. Oh man, my throat is not used to talking this long. So yeah, notepad, something that can be opened up instantly. I have a notepad on my desktop set straight to my idea list. I also have a planner, a paper planner right next to my computer with a pencil. That way I can write down an idea if I have one. I also have another little booklet that I can write down ideas in as well. just in case my planner is missing for some reason. I always have some way to get ideas. I also get lots of ideas while I'm taking my dog for a walk. But in those situations, I just use my memory tricks to not forget it. Because I don't have a good memory baseline, and I totally have to use my memory tricks in order to remember stuff. In which case, I'll never forget it. Because those memory tricks are legit. If you're a student right now, you should totally just look up, like, just type in memory tricks in YouTube and just learn everything you can, because your memory can be manipulated to a surprising degree. You can literally, like, double the amount of stuff you can remember, because most people are taught in school only how to do rote memorization. That is, just saying something over and over until you memorize it, which is a terrible way to memorize shit. That's like the, that's like novice level. The advanced stuff is so much easier to memorize stuff than rote memorization, which I really wish I'd known earlier, because rote memorization's the worst. Just saying something over and over until you memorize it. Ugh. Archaic, barbaric way of remembering things. Anyways, what else was I talking about? Notepad on my desktop can be opened up. A daily planner with the pencil. I never forget my ideas, and I always add more to my list than I actually make. That's true. I always add more videos to my list than I actually end up making. So I have a huge-ass idea list video. I'll probably never run out of ideas. Maybe I'll someday transition to making videos about other stuff besides WoW. In which case, my idea list will get even bigger. But in the meantime, I just keep that to my other channels. Alright, so I'm gonna go drink a water real quick, and then I'll continue. Man, my throat got hella dry. Okay. What else was I talking about? I just talked about how to get yourself to do something creative. How to force the creative juices to flow. Don't be a hippie and don't work only when you're inspired. Force yourself to become inspired. And then you'll get inspired. Because your body and your brain can be manipulated if you know how to do it. Okay, so next question. Firstly, that podcast story you told was fucking hilarious. Question, what is your favorite anime / manga? My favorite anime / manga is probably... Ah, shit, I totally forgot. I just finished reading a manga recently that was really, really good. But before that, it was totally The World God Only Knows. Because The World God Only Knows is, I don't know, it just has everything going well for it. It has a very interesting premise, or should I say a very unique premise to it. The main character is really interesting and funny. The situations they get into are legitimately funny. And since the main character is a good main character, who's not a cowardly piece of shit and actually knows how to get shit done, it makes it that much better. The characters are written extremely well. And there are so many different ones. And then the plot itself is nonsensical, but the situations they're in are really funny, and the characters totally carried the story until the plot did get good. And I was like, oh shit, I didn't think the author would take it this way, and then it got really good. And then it ended, and I was like, oh, that was really good. Totally my favorite. It's also an anime as well. The world God only knows. Oh, that's so funny. The premise sounds stupid. Like, if you read it, it has probably got to be one of those things where if you read the premise for it, it sounds ridiculous. But when you actually watch it, it's pulled off very well. It's supposed to be crazy, you know, like a gimmick. And then he actually turns that into a good story. I was like, I was not expecting that. That was so well done. And I really liked it. But then recently I read Spirit Circle, and that was just so good. Oh my god, Spirit Circle's got to be the best manga I've ever read. Even though I really like The World God Only Knows, I also really like Hunter x Hunter. That's also really good. Meruem the King from Hunter x Hunter, he's like my favorite character ever. God, he's so amazing. So yeah, there's Hunter x Hunter. The World God Only Knows, Spirit Circle, the manga. It doesn't have an anime. That was so great. It's probably the best story I've ever read. And then there's Madoka Magica for anime. That one's really good, too. I really like Madoka Magica. That's an anime-only thing. It doesn't have a manga version to it. So I guess those four things I would highly recommend. Hunter x Hunter, Madoka Magica, The World God Only Knows, and Spirit Circle. You might notice that I didn't actually mention anything about the shows themselves specifically. That was intentional, otherwise I would have gone into a huge tangent explaining about what all of those shows are and their premises. Instead, I just kept it intentionally vague so I can finish this video in under an hour. Next question. Hello, Hiru-sama. By the time you read this, for your next Q&A, you would have already done most of the content in 7.0.3. My question is, what is your favorite cutscene in Legion so far? My favorite has to be, spoiler alert, the cutscene where the corrupted Ysera dies, and Ilune turns her spirit into a constellation, leaving her Tyr in Ysera's place. Broke my heart. I hate how so many characters are dying at the moment. First Tyrion, then Varian, then Vol'jin, and now my favorite former dragon aspect. Wait a minute, speculation mode activated, Chris Metzen retiring, so many characters dying, conflict between kingdoms, unity to fight a certain evil in the rise, resurrecting a fallen hero, is George R.R. Martin behind all this? We know nothing. Intensifies, yeah, I'm a huge fan of George R.R. Martin. I've read all of his fan theories and a whole bunch of books that are... I have this really good book that's like a combination of essays written about Game of Thrones. In addition to having read all the books, in addition to watching the TV show, the books and the TV show are completely different at this point. Like, the TV show went off in a completely different direction. But yeah, World of Warcraft is very simple compared to Game of Thrones. So I wouldn't say that, but I mean, I kind of get what you mean when you say George R.R. Martin, because that's usually what people say when main characters die. Just because in Game of Thrones, the main character, who would originally be a main character in any other fantasy setting, dies at the end of the first season. Plus, a whole bunch of other main characters die in it, too. But there's a whole bunch more to Game of Thrones that makes it amazing. But one of the main features of the thing is obviously that main characters die, so I kind of get it. And as for WoW, yeah, they've been killing off main characters. It's still nowhere near Game of Thrones level of complex. And it doesn't have to be. Just complex does not equal good. But in Game of Thrones case, it's really good. It just happens to also be complex. I do like WoW's story as well. It doesn't have to be super complex to be interesting. I'm in the middle of listening through all of the WoW books on my iPod while I go running in the morning. So I usually run for like, I don't know, half an hour to 40 minutes, 45 minutes. That's a good enough time to listen to an audiobook if you do that every day. Anyways, to say all that, conflict between the kingdoms, that's always how it's kind of been. They just killed off more major characters to really sell the whole Legion is a big threat thing, which I think they've done a wonderful job of doing. But I don't really know where it's going to go. I'm interested to see where it's going to go, and I hope it doesn't become cliche, but WoW has surprised me in the past, which is great because I'm not usually surprised by turn of events and stories. And I do really like WoW's story because they do surprise me sometimes, which is pretty great. So anyways, to answer the question, what's my favorite cutscene? The one with Sylvanas and Greymane fighting, because Sylvanas is total waifu bait. She's the best, even if she is a little bit evil. Plus, Greymane's cool too. I do like both of them, not because I care for Greymane's story or anything, but because he's a fun character to play in Heroes of the Storm. So it's like, I do like Sylvanas from a lore point of view, but I also like Greymane from a Heroes of the Storm point of view, because he's a fun character to play in Heroes of the Storm. Because Greymane probably has like some of the best burst auto attacks in Heroes of the Storm. So if he jumps in you on Worgen form, you gotta get away from him ASAP, otherwise he's gonna tear you apart. So much fun to play. He's also squishy as shit. Then again, I'm not gonna talk about Heroes of the Storm in this video, you guys don't care. So yeah, the one with Sylvanas and Heroes of the Storm guy, Greymane fighting each other, because that was pretty cool. Next question. Although the phrase is nonsense, it does have a long history. The phrase has been used for several centuries to typographers to show the most distinctive features of their fonts. It is used because the letters involved and the letter spacing in those combinations reveal, at their best, the weight, design, and other important features of the typeface. A 1994 issue of Before and After magazine traces Lorem Ipsum to a jumbled Latin version of a passage from De Finibus Bonorum et Malorum, a treatise on the theory of ethics written by Cicero in 54 BC. The passage, Lorem Ipsum, is taken from the text that reads something in Latin, which translates as, there is no one who loves pain itself, who seeks after it and wants to have it, because it is pain. During the 1500s, a printer named Cicero's text, printer adapted Cicero's text to develop a page of type samples. Since then, the Latin-like text has been the printer's... Man, I keep losing. This is a really long thing. And my mic is in the way. I lost my place. Since then, the Latin-like text has been the printing industry's standard for fake or dummy text. Oh, should I miss a sentence? During the 1500s, a printer adapted Cicero's text to develop a page of type samples. Since then, the Latin-like text has been the printer industry standard for fake or dummy text. Before electronic publishing, graphic designers had to mock up layouts by drawing in squiggled lines to indicate text. The advent of self-adhesive sheets pre-printed with Lorem Ipsum gave a more realistic way to indicate where the text would go on page. Man. You see, this is why I put lots of editing into whenever I read my scripts. If you were to listen to a full script without any of the audio edits taken out, you'd see that I stumble over my words a lot, even though I wrote them myself. Mainly because I'm dyslexic. Yeah. That's basically why. This is why I practice with my Ask Reddit channel, which I haven't made a video on in a while. Basically, all that was just explaining the Lorem Ipsum Dolor thing. On any of my videos, you can set a default for what goes into your video description. So I have like my default thing with all of my social media links and nonsense like that, because who wants to go in and type or copy and paste those every time I make a new video? You can just set defaults. And I set at the top of my default thing, lorem ipsum dolor, because it's nonsense text that printers use. That way I can just replace it with something else. And I sometimes forget to replace it, or I just don't do it intentionally because I don't feel like putting anything there. Kind of like when I make Q&A videos. Sometimes I'll just leave in the jumbled up text. I also have that for my Sony Vegas, because I have like default fonts and colors and like shadows to some of the text I use, and I'll just use lorem ipsum dolor for that. That way I can just replace it later. So if any of my videos have lorem ipsum dolor in them with text across the picture somewhere, that's because I forgot to take it out, but I doubt that'll happen. With how much time and effort goes into editing, it's really hard to make that mistake. Because you literally watch the video like 100 times, it's so annoying. After you finish editing a video together, you never want to watch it again because you've literally watched every single frame of the video like 10 times over. But yeah, that's just the fake text I use. He was just, you probably just copy and paste the thing from Wikipedia explaining what the fake text is that I use. Because everybody uses it. I just copy and paste it too. I just type in lorem ipsum into the computer and it'll generate lorem ipsum fake text, and you can just copy and paste it as much as you want. Actually, I'm pretty sure there's programs too that will fill out stuff with the fake text as well that newspapers will use to see if the words look right in their columns and shit. I forgot where I learned it from. I think it was in a HTML class or something. I don't know. Next question. Do you always say, all right, so, when you start talking in real life as well? All right, so, in, like, all of my Yu-Gi-Oh! Videos and my pet battle videos, and I think in all of my Q&As, I'll usually start off the video with, all right, so, time to start up. Here's Q&A number 27. So yeah, I always start everything with all right, so. Not everything, but like 90% of the things I do. And that is intentional, but it didn't start off that way. It's originally, I just didn't want to make an intro for anything, because I always thought those were super fake and stupid. So I would just start out with, okay, so this is how the deck works. Or, all right, so this is how this pet battle team works. You know, instead of having an intro like, hey everybody, I'm the Duel Logs, and today we'll be going over this deck about virus cards. It's crazy. Instead, I just try to keep it a more conversational tone, make it seem like I'm down to earth, and, you know, someone would be really chill to talk to. And that's why I go with the, alright, so this is how this deck works. It's to give off the illusion that I'm a normal person who would be really fun to talk to. Even though in reality, I'm an introvert who doesn't like to talk to people. But I know how to. I've learned the techniques by practicing and reading books about it. If you want to learn how to talk to people, I recommend reading the book How to Win Friends and Influence People. I know how the book sounds stupid, but it's like literally like one of the best books you can read. It's so good. It should be called How to Manipulate People. It's so great. God, I love that book so much. If you are interested in anything about psychology or how to be a better talker, or because social skills are something you do need if you want to interact with other human beings, even if you don't want to. I don't like talking to people, but I had to learn how to anyway. So I practice a whole bunch of things, and one of the things I really found that people like is when you seem to be someone who doesn't take things too seriously, but at the same time doesn't sound like they're lazy. You have to like strike a balance between that, make it seem like you're a really cool person to talk to, and it's all formulated, but it's formulated in a way that makes it seem like it's not. Like, that's the kind of personality I actually have. In reality, my actual personality is that of like a robot who doesn't do anything. So basically everything is fake. I'm nothing but just a collection of fake stuff that I thought would be interesting or pleasing to other people. Because my default self is, well, it's fine, but I mean, if I want to talk to other people, it's not effective or the most efficient way of doing it. Some of the worst advice you can give someone is to just be yourself. Because what if being yourself is an asshole? Usually people who aren't assholes will use that as an excuse to excuse their behavior. Like, hey, I'm just being myself. Or, yeah, I'm just a bitch. That's just who I am. I talk shit about people behind their back. You know me. Just being yourself. I always think that's one of those things that shouldn't be treated so highly. More like, be the best version of yourself. Be who you want to be. And pretend to be them. But, I mean, then again, there are problems with that as well. Like, if you pretend to be, I don't know, super nice, people will take advantage of you. That's not good. So you gotta, you know limits to it. Obviously, there's, you know, extremes to every kind of generic advice like that. But the whole be yourself thing is stupid. Also, the whole thing about knowing someone's true self is also bullshit. Like, oh, I thought you were a nice person to talk to, but I found out this secret about you, and now I know who you really are. Or, I heard you talk shit about me behind my back, now I know how you really think of me. No, it's more like they think that as well as they think the other stuff. It's not like people are black and white, they only have one side to them, and the one side that is truly them just happens to be the bad thing you found out about. No, it's more like that's another side to the person. People are a collection of things. People are complex. They're not simple. Like TV shows would have you believe. The reason they do that in TV shows a lot, or in movies, is because it's easy to write. It's easy drama. But in real life, people take what they watch. People are very impressionable, and they'll incorporate that into their real lives. Everybody does it. I do it. People just don't realize it because it gets ingrained in them. If you see something enough portrayed as being normal, you'll eventually internalize it as something that is normal. Kind of like the whole real self bullshit that's also brought up in popular culture. That's not real either. You are a collection of things. You are not one thing. You can be nice to people in public and then talk shit about them behind your back. You could still think those nice things about them, but you can also think bad things about people. Because, you know, people aren't perfect. And you also, it's totally normal to not want people to find out about those things you say. Gossip is like one of the most universal things done by humans. Everybody gossips. I don't really do it anymore, but I had lots of women friends, so I know all of them gossip. So do guys, too. Just because you talk bad about someone behind their back doesn't mean you necessarily hate them and don't want to talk to them anymore. That's the reason you're saying behind their back and not in front of them. Of course, there's situations where that's also not true as well. They totally can just hate their guts and just pretend to like them in person. That is totally a thing that happens as well. And there's also situations in which people will think, oh, that's the real you, when it doesn't have to do with gossip as well. But yeah, I'm not going to go into more about that. I just really went off on a tangent about that. You always say, all right, so yeah, it's because I'm trying to pretend to be a chill person. I tried to pretend to be someone who seems like they're not pretending to be anyone. It's all a double subterfuge. You're being tricked because it makes me seem likable. I think it works. There are other ways to do it as well, but I think that's the one I can do pretty easy because it's a pretty easy thing to act out. After all, it's not too far from the truth. Okay, let's try to I have like four more questions left. I'm going to try to speed through them. Next question. Are the new YouTube ad-friendly rules going to affect you? And how badly do you think it will affect you? Oh, okay, I had to read that. Okay, so the first question is, do you think they'll affect me? And then the second question is basically assuming I'm going to say yes. Or if I do say yes, how badly will it affect you? Okay, I kind of get you now. So like a month ago, they revealed the ads thing where if your video has content that it's not ad friendly, they won't monetize your videos. That's been in YouTube forever. I've already known about it, and it's not going to affect me in any way. And when it was brought up, I was always... every time something like that is brought up for YouTube, everybody just blows it way out of proportion because it gets views. Kind of like when YouTube Red was introduced, everybody was like, oh my god, I don't know how YouTube Red's going to affect my videos. Even though I read the release statement, I was like, oh, this is cool. But then everyone had their own different opinions on it. It's like, oh no, this is the end of the world. And then YouTube Red went out, and it turns out it was a good thing for people. And the new ad-friendly rules, oh no, everybody's going to get their things demonetized. You have to be careful. This popular YouTuber had his videos demonetized. Oh, you can't swear anymore. You can't say bad words anymore. You can't swear. Everybody was just basically strawmanning that argument to hell. Basically, there's a whole bunch of things that could get your videos demonetized. A whole bunch of things like, obviously, that would get your video demonetized. I mean, if you're showing boobs in your video and it doesn't get taken down, of course you're not going to get any views on that. If you're showing people killing each other with real-life war footage, of course you're going to get demonetized for that. That's violence. If you're going to show gore, you're going to get demonetized if they don't just take it down. Showing people killing each other, showing pictures of pigs getting stabbed. I only laugh at that because someone links that in the Skype channel sometimes. I never actually watched the video, but I know it has a whole bunch of dislikes. And there's a whole bunch of people in the comment section who says basically what happened to the video. I was like, oh, okay, that's something I'm never going to watch. But yeah, those videos never got monetized. That's always been something in the YouTube system. I've known about that forever. But one of the things they could demonetize you for was if you used excess language. I was like, okay, so that probably means if someone's just saying the N-word over and over. Or if someone's just... I can only really think of that. So they're saying the N-word like over and over and over and over. Maybe just saying it repeatedly. I was like, yeah, I can totally see why they would demonetize that. But they were doing the straw man argument, a logical fallacy. And saying it's like, oh no, I accidentally said fuck in a video. Now it's going to get demonetized. It's like, no, they won't do that. I mean, someone could totally troll your video and say, oh, they curse a whole bunch in this video. And that could totally go through, but that's like an outlier case. Something you don't really include into a generalized view of that kind of thing. It was a nonsense argument, and I knew that. I knew they were going to focus on that one thing when I saw the release statement for it. I was like, everybody is going to blow this one part of the article out of proportion in order to say that the entire thing is stupid. They're all going to focus on the bad word thing. I just knew it. And what do you know? Every YouTuber who reports on it is like, oh no, I can't cuss anymore because YouTube won't let me out monetize my video. And I think I only saw like one of them mention anything else about it. I think Total Biscuit was like the only person I saw who publicly talked about it, who actually talked about it in the real ways. Like, yeah, it doesn't really matter. This is how it's always been. And it's been like a month, and now nobody talks about it anymore. Because it wasn't a big deal. But obviously there are some outliers where it can screw you over. And even in those outlier cases, it's not really a big deal. Next question. It gets longer and longer. I started to think you use this as therapy for yourself? Well, I do like talking about myself, so I can't completely rule that out. Next question. Hiro, Sylvanas, or Greymane? Ooh, I totally already talked about that. Sylvanas, she's total waifu bait. Greymane is totally fun too, but only because I like him in Heroes of the Storm. Don't really care for his lore. Not that his lore is like super boring or anything, it's just Sylvanas is so much better. So that's it. What does this say right here? I'm working on Dave and DevBot. Oh yeah, if you want to watch the episodes early. Or see how it's progressing if you're a fan of it, like all two of you people who might be watching this. Who also happen to like that. It'll be on my Reddit page, or you can just go to my Patreon page, and I'll make sure to put those as anyone can view. You can set your Patreon feed for, like, only your Patreons can view it, or people who go on the page can see it, and I'll make sure to put those as, like, everyone can see it, so you don't actually have to pay money to see the early progress on Dave and DevBot. I'll do that from now on, I mean, they're all set behind the Patreon-only thing. Because Patreon's a good way. I do all of my updates and shit through Patreon. like after I make every video, because I always put my video up on Patreon first. Well, I mean, I upload it to YouTube, but then I put the unlisted link on Patreon first, and then I'll put the video to public like a day or two later, depending on how quickly I get it up. And then I'll write everything about my progress, like how long I spent working on the video, everything that went into it. Sometimes I'll put like screenshots during the week talking about it. Patreon seems like a really fun place to talk about my videos and stuff. Because really, where else am I going to put it? Twitter? No one cares about that stuff. Patreon's the best place where I can talk about my daily life of working with YouTube videos and stuff. Also, once I finish Dave and DevBot, I really want to work on my InZoth series. I really want to hire someone to make that for me, honestly. Because I want to do the InZoth Machinima series. It's only going to be like 4 episodes. Unlike my Dave and DevBot one, that's going to be 8 episodes long for the second season. The InZoth story, I think that one's going to do well. Maybe. Maybe. I really like it. Hopefully it turns out well, because there are Dave and DevBot episodes where I rent them out and like, oh, this is gonna be great, it's gonna be really funny, and then I actually go and record the lines and put it together, and I was like, this is kind of mediocre, and then I'll rewrite it. I've done that already twice with the second season. It's like, this isn't as funny as I thought it would be. But so far the InZoth scripts I have written down, I sound really funny on paper, but I hope they turn out well when I put them into video form as well, because it doesn't always happen. It does happen, but sometimes it doesn't. And I hope InZoth video isn't one of those sometimes it doesn't happen. But it would also be a lot of fun if I just hired someone to do that. But then again, I hired 2 people to make Dave and DevBot episodes, and they both ended up flaking out. That was a bad experience. Wow, it's really hard to find people who know how to do machinimas, who aren't teenagers, who don't know how to tell you when they don't want to work on it anymore.